and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Reading from the first letter of Peter. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you are doing right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse, When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that free from sin, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and the guardian of your soul. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him, because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers." Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and will go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Would you pray with me? We thank you, O God, for the gift of your love. And we offer and present to you, so far as we are able, all that we are, all that we have, and all that we do, as only an emptiness to be filled by you until you are all in all and we are complete. We pray through the one who is the very fullness of your love, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We think of stories about sheep and shepherds as sweet, warm, and cuddly. I mean, look at the window right over my shoulder there with Jesus snuggling up the poor little lamb who is snuggling. It reminds me, I have a mini golden doodle who will jump up in your lap and just snuggle like crazy. And it's usually when we want him to do something he doesn't want to do. And he jumps up in my lap and snuggles, save me, Daddy, save me from doing what I don't want to do. So that's the image of the Good Shepherd that we all love. I mean, we give little stuffed lambs to babies, you know, little stuffed animals to babies of lambs. But our lesson today, in its original context, was not sweet and warm and cuddly. Our lesson today comes towards the end of a discussion that Jesus is having with the Pharisees, you see? If you'll remember, a few weeks ago, we had the story of the man born blind whom Jesus healed on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees got all bent out of the frame because he was healing on the Sabbath, and they reacted with an arrogant spiritual blindness. Let me read you the verses that immediately precede our lesson today. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say we see, your sin remains. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep." And then later Jesus continues, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am this gate." And so in our passage today, as much as we would like to have a warm, cuddly little sheep nestling in the bosom of Jesus, we don't have that. We have a fight between the Pharisees and Jesus. We don't have the lesson about I'm the good or ideal shepherd. That comes a little later, a few verses later on. Instead, if we were going to call today anything, instead of calling it Good Shepherd Sunday, we would call it Thief and Bandit Sunday. Whoa. Because Jesus is busy calling the pious people of his time, the Pharisees, a bunch of thieves and bandits. And he identifies himself as the door or gate for the sheep. He says, I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. The gospel according to John is the one and only gospel that has no parables in it. John just didn't have parables. But our lesson today comes as close as John ever comes to having parables. He has stories. I have to admit that John does it in a way that's a little confusing because this lesson has two sort of semi-parables about sheep in it. The first one is about the thieves and bandits who try to enter the sheepfold in a way that's not the gate. And the second parable is about the shepherd whose sheep recognize his voice. And the stories or semi-parables shift back and forth in John's discussion a couple of times. And so it's a little like mixing your metaphors, as it were. Something that would drive my English teachers into apoplexy. Fortunately for John, there were no English teachers editing the gospel of the according to John, or he'd be in trouble. So for the moment, I want us to stick to the part about Jesus being the door of the sheep. What does it mean for Jesus to be the gate for us sheep? It means that Jesus creates the way for his sheep to enter the safety of the sheepfold, to protect them from the dangers of the world, not only the thieves and bandits, but also the wolves and other predators who would get us poor little healthy sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for the sheep, and the sheep hear the shepherd's voice, and the gate of his death is the resurrection, so that the sheep may have life and have it abundantly. I think this story is about the resurrection and the cost of salvation that Jesus paid. I believe that Jesus is the gatekeeper opening the gate is about opening the tomb on that first Easter morning. And that's why I think we have this lesson sitting here staring us in the face right in the middle of Easter season. The word for gate, we translate it as gate, is the in Greek is thyra, and it means a door, like those doors back there at the other end of the church. But it can also mean the door on a cabinet or closet, or it can also mean the gate on a fence. So it might be stretching it a bit, but it might also even be construed to be the door on the cave tomb where Jesus was. And so Jesus, in his resurrection and death, provides for us sheep the way to everlasting and abundant life. And the Pharisees, who were thieves and bandits, couldn't do that. They couldn't go through that gate. They could not offer an authentic way to everlasting life simply because they could not pay the price that Jesus paid for us. Now, here's the really cool part. How could Jesus be both the gate and the shepherd whose voice we sheep recognize? Well, Professor E.F. Bishop notes in an article many years ago that in Palestine, Palestinian sheepfolds often do not have wooden gates on them. They're just sort of corrals of stone, you know, sort of a square rectangular corral with just a little gap there to be the gate. And so the shepherds will often lie down across the entrance to the sheepfold, and their bodies form the physical gate that keep us sheep in the sheepfold and keep the wolves and the other predators out. And so the shepherds are both shepherds and gates at the same time. pretty neat, huh? Take that, all you English teachers who worry about mixing metaphors. We have a shepherd who is also a gate. He calls his sheep by name. We're told that Palestinian shepherds will nickname their sheep like long ears or white nose or something like that about their characteristics. And so the point is that Jesus calls us each individually to follow him. Again, he says, I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. Think about that statement for a bit. In the context of our own death and afterlife, that we will come into the tomb and we will go out of the tomb following the voice of our shepherd to find pasture. Perhaps that's why this passage is one of the lessons appointed for use at funerals, because we sheep can follow the voice of the good shepherd both into the tomb and out of the tomb into eternal life. And so in these two connected semi-parables, we have a metaphor for death and resurrection and a condemnation of all those who would try to avoid the path, and a promise that Jesus will lead us through the tombs of our death and into the safe pastures of the resurrection. These stories are also about authenticity, about who is a real shepherd and who's a fake. It's about who is the real gate for the sheep and who are the thieves and robbers. They're about how some people appear from the outside to be very pious and proper, but in reality, they're not really authentic. They're not the real thing. It's about thieves and bandits who pretend to be shepherds, but instead try to make a buck off of their sheep instead of laying their lives down to protect the sheep. Well, I was thinking this week about who the modern day thieves and bandits might be. And it's easy for me to stand here and talk about flashy megachurch folks who have big yachts and private jet planes and 16,000 seat churches and private fortunes of $100 million. That's just easy pickings, and I'm not gonna do it. But I'm likewise not gonna say that poverty makes us authentic either, you know? Poverty is just miserable. But you know, the good book does say that you cannot serve God and wealth at the same time. And it also tells us that camels can sail through the hole in the needle of your Singer sewing machine easier than rich folk can get into the gates of heaven. So the point is to look for authenticity in your faith. Look for a faith that's interested in how Jesus lived and who he was and what he says. There's an old and anonymous poem which says it best, I think. Lots of great wisdom is contained in old and anonymous things, but this poem is just right on the nose. It says, thou shalt know him when he comes, not by any din of drums, nor by his manners, nor his air, nor by anything he wears. Thou shalt know him when he comes, not by his gown or by his crown, but his coming known shall be by the holy harmony which his coming makes in thee. So look for the authentic. Look for the thing that resonates with you as real and authentic faith. The faith that seeks to serve rather than to be served. The faith that offers love and acceptance rather than judgment or condemnation. The faith that embodies Paul's advice in Philippians that we talked about on Wednesday. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. That's what the real authentic faith is. So look for the church that focuses on the positive, the things that are worthy of praise. Look for the faith that sees our little children and the pets entrusted to our care as gifts and treasures to be nurtured and loved. Look for the faith that treasures our heritage but also embraces the present with gusto and looks for the future with expectancy and hope. Look for the faith that loves God's creativity and sees the amazing and beautiful diversity, both of humanity and the diversity of all creation, as a strength and a gift to be cherished and blessed and rejoiced over instead of stamped out in some crazy path toward conformity. Look for on this authenticity and look for love. Look for a faith that shares what it has unselfishly, that gives and blesses and serves. Look for a faith that crosses boundaries and loves and embraces all of God's people. And you know what? I think that all you have to do to find this authentic and wonderful faith is to look around you within these four walls. For that is what St. Paul's has been for me for this past year. And I hope and pray that it will continue to be exactly like that for each one of you as you turn a new page and welcome your new rector. So, happy trails. Happy trails to you until we meet again. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand and join in the words of the Nicene Creed found in your bulletin on page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer.
We believe in one God, Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, but one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified in a conscious Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people, form 6, are found on page 392 in the Book of Common Prayer or in your service bulletin. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For Sarah, Maggie, Father Mark, Josh, Alan, Melanie, Emily, Robin, Paul, April, and Michelle. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
In our diocese, peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and His Church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
Remembering especially this day, Joanne, James, Martha, and Helen, we pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
We pray also to you for the forgiveness of our sins.
Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, knowing and unknown, things done and left unknown. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
This the fourth Sunday within the season of Easter. We're about halfway through the Easter season, and I would tell you what's going to happen next week, but I won't be here. Reverend Candis will know more about what's happening next week. I think the Wednesday Bible study will happen at 10:30, and I assume that the Wednesday Bible study people will make sure it happens at 10:30 one way or another.
Amen.
So, good. And that will happen. Other than that, I'm not really sure. Next Sunday will be the Reverend Candace's first Sunday here as the new rector of St. Paul's. And you will have a fabulous covered dish lunch after the service, which will be exactly as fabulous as you make it, because covered dish lunches are like that. So bring your best home recipe that is treasured and loved by people that you know. Let's see, is there something else, Kevin, coming up?
Well, more importantly, as different as Father is, we are going to have a barbecue right after this service over in the parish hall. So we hope you all will stick around as we end Father Ed's ministry here with us at St. Paul's with a glorious barbecue lunch.
And Keenan Taylor has made her fantastic Texas barbecue brisket.
Don't hop it up too much.
I just love the Texas barbecue brisket. If you've ever had it, it's different from North Carolina barbecue, but just as wonderful. And it's beef for those of you who think barbecue only comes in pork.
There is chicken too.
Oh, there's also chicken. So we're in good shape.
If you didn't bring anything, be at peace. You are supposed to. Please.
Yeah.
All the fixings have been already assigned out to other people, so please do stick around and have lunch. And with that,
also, we have for the ladies, there's going to be a Mother's Day tea. Sorry, fellas, you're not invited. and it's going to be glorious. We're going to do it out in the Memorial Garden, and it'll be the Saturday before Mother's Day, and it should be, I can't remember the time, but it should be in the announcement. So bring your springy hats, and we're going to do all things girly in Mother's.
cuddly.
Tony, do you have something?
Yes. The Lord has really blessed me through this whole week. And it come up, I was something this past, 1 week from this last Thursday, and they had to take me to the emergency room.
And are you doing okay now?
Yes, I'm doing
okay. I think you must be doing okay because you're sitting in our pew instead of a hospital bed.
Yes.
Yeah.
He asked my prayer for the relief from me also.
Good. Oh, are they birthdays and anniversaries that we've had this week?
Carol.
Well, come on, Carol, is it birthday?
On Wednesday.
Birthday on Wednesday. Here, I will come to Carol. Do we have any others? Here we go. Come on, Joe.
No, my mother's 63 today.
Oh, your mother's 63. Yes. What's your mother's name?
Regina.
Watch over your servants, Carol and Regina, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Lift them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. And happy birthday to Regina. Where is she?
Somewhere in Asheville. It was a surprise birthday trip, so I don't...
Surprise birthday trip in Asheville. There are worse places to go for your birthday. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most
Thank you.
he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of you and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy